voice and say now, hallelujah. You have won it all for me. Eraboha nabaha. Eraboha eta. You are the risen King, yeah. You're seated in majesty, well. You are the risen King. Hey.
I strive
with my head.
Eyes never perish, hands free.
Hey, Tabo, Tata.
Eyes blood, where was sweet. And now we have
the victory. And the power of sin. Hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He has won.
He has won.
Yes, he has. He has won it all.
For me.
So every voice
we sang now. Lift up your voice and say, hallelujah.
You have won it all
for me. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King. Well, you're seated in majesty. You are the risen King. Hallelujah. Death could not hold him down. He abolished death. He said, death, where is your sting? Oh, grave, where is your victory?
Stretch out your hands,
stretch out your hands and say, Nada Bo
Shanabaha.
Woo! Hey! Nada. Ain't you glad about it? Aren't you glad about it? If it had not been for the Lord on my side, I don't know where I'd be. I don't know. Hey! Baba Ba Shanababa. Hallelujah. Bam! Hey! Woo! We sing now. Have your way in this place. Lord God, bless your word. Master, bless your word on today. Hallelujah. Yay. He's risen. The angel asked Mary Magdalene, why are you looking for the living amongst the dead? He's not here. He has risen. Hallelujah. He got up. If he got up, we gonna get up. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. I'm so glad about it. I'm so glad about it. He told him, no man take my life. He said, I lay it down, but in 3 days, I'll pick it up again. Glory to God. Glory to God. The risen King. He's alive. My God lives. Job put it this way. My Redeemer lives. Hallelujah. That a motion of a heart. Yeah. That a motion. Glory to God. No man take it my life. So Jesus spoke boldly. They thought that he was a lunatic. They said either he's who he say he is or he's a lunatic. Well, I stopped by to tell the house of bread, my God is alive and he's living. I greet you all in Jesus' name. I come before you in the name of a prophet. We won't be before you long, but we do have a prophetic word from the Lord. Let us go right into prayer. Amen. First, I'd like to thank for having my friend, my pastor. Pastor Wells is in the house. Somebody shout, Pastor Wells is in the house. Hallelujah.
Pastor Wells is in the house.
At our Abosha, every head bowed, every eye closed. Eternal Father, gracious Lord, the risen King. Father God, I thank you for this opportunity to stand one more time. Stand in the name of Jesus, the name above every name. Lord God, I thank you. Now, Father God, I rebuke every attack of the enemy.
Amen.
I come against every assignment of the enemy. I plead the blood of Jesus. I plead the blood of Jesus. I plead the blood of Jesus on Satan. I plead the blood of Jesus on Jezebel. I plead the blood of Jesus on Beelzebub. I bind every witch and every warlock. I cast down every root working sorcerer and cast them down back to hell from where they come from. And I command them to get out of my ministry right now in Jesus' name. Now, Father God, I pray for my team. Lord God, I pray for victory in every aspect of their life. Lord God, I pray for Paige Studio. I pray for Comcast Channel 9, Comcast Channel 10, Comcast Channel 19. I pray, Lord God, that you take them higher. In Jesus' name I pray. Now, Master, remember your manservant on today. Anoint these lips of clay. Make the tongue like the pen of the ready writer. And I'll bless your holy name for it in the name of Jesus. Now, Lord God, send your word. Lord God, send your word. Lord God, send your word. Lord God, send your anointing. Lord God, send your anointing. Lord God, send your anointing in Jesus' name. Now, Father God, heal somebody. Lord God, save somebody. Lord God, deliver somebody. Lord God, bless somebody in Jesus' name, I pray. Now, Father God, make the preaching easy. And the teaching good, and I bless your holy name for it in the name of Jesus. Now, Lord God, all these things I ask in your name, in Jesus' precious name, I pray. Amen, amen. And let the redeemer of the Lord say, amen, and amen. It is so. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You have won the victory. Hallelujah. You have won it all for me. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King. You're seated in majesty. Well, you are the risen King. Saints of God, my text is coming from the book, the writing of the prophet Isaiah, the eagle-eyed prophet Isaiah. Amen. Very familiar passage of scripture, Isaiah chapter 54, verse 17. I sincerely solicit your prayers on today. And the words of God are recorded like this in the book of Isaiah chapter 54, verse 17. No weapons that is formed against me, no weapons that are formed against thee shall prosper. And every tongue that has risen against thee in judgment, thou shall condemn. This is the heritage of the servant of the Lord. And their righteousness is of me, says the Lord. Amen. Saints of God, my text on today, the pulling down of strongholds. Somebody say, teach, Bishop.
Teach, Bishop.
The pulling down of strongholds. Saints of God, do you understand here that what the prophet is saying, that every time the enemy comes up against you, that it's null and void? Every time that the enemy has attacked you, that it has no power over you, because God has blessed you with the ability to withstand every attack of the enemy. He told his disciples, I give thee power, power to tread on serpents, to walk on scorpions. He says, I've seen Satan fall like lightning. Understanding that a stronghold
is also a generational curse. Tarabusha. Knowing here that I come not by my own strength, not by my own power, but by the power of the living God, that I rebuke and I bind every generational curse. I come against every stronghold. A stronghold is something that the enemy has put on you that you believe that you can never get rid of. You think it's a part of you. Well, the devil is a liar. A stronghold is like anything else. It can be removed. Jesus asked his disciples, is there anything too hard for your God to do? Knowing here that the writer says that no weapons formed against you. He's not speaking of earthly weapons, saints of God. You can't fight the enemy with an AK-47. You can't fight him with a butcher knife. You can't fight him with earthly weapons. You got to fight him in the spirit. You got to fight him with spiritual warfare. You got to understand that you do have a devil to fight. But as long as you walking in this mortal body, you have a God that is able to withstand and give you the ability to do beyond and exceedingly and above measure than what you could ever ask or think. Somebody shout, preach. Knowing now that because of who God is and God all by himself, he has called you to be more than just a conqueror, but an overcomer. When you think about the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for you, your soul should cry out and shout, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, I thank you for saving me. Knowing now that because of God, you do not have to be into the crack house any longer. Stay with the bishop. You're knowing now because of God and your ability to understand right from wrong, that God will forgive you of all of your sins. But first, you must come to a state of repentance. Repentance was birthed on the cross. You don't hear the bishop. Repentance, without repentance, man is doomed. See, man lived first by the law of Moses. Amen. But when Jesus wrapped himself up in flesh, came down to earth, amen, and let them nail him to a tree, he not only gave birth to repentance, but he gave birth to salvation. First, they led him to the whipping post. That Abosha. The Bible said, by his stripes we were healed. 39 stripes and one lash. The Bible says that he was beat down so immensely that he was walking in a bow shot. It was leading him to, amen, a place called Gargantuan. You know it as Calvary. Gargantuan means the valley of the skull. So you see, during the first century, crucifixion was the way of death. It wasn't something just planned for Jesus. It's how the Romans killed people. But you must understand that they would just cut them down from that tree, that cross they were on, and they would drop in a hole. And the only thing, amen, that would last would be the back of the head. They call it the valley of the skulls. I ran track, amen, stay with the bishop. I ran track with a guy that was from Nigeria. Kenya. Thank you, Holy Ghost. My help is all over me now. He was from Kenya, and he was saying that in the bush, sometime the warrior is not too skilled with the arrow. See, he spoke like in parables. I said, what do you mean? He said they would go out to hunt game, but the lion is out there also. He said they're not too skilled. In other words, sometimes they miss with the arrow. But what he was saying was a lot of people would be missing. And when they would find nothing but the back of the head on the trail, the valley of the skulls. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Knowing now that because God has said that you don't have to worry about tomorrow. Don't worry about your clothes. He says, I take care of the sparrows. You are more valuable to God than the sparrows. As I look here in the book of 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, stay with the bishop. I'm going somewhere. 2 Corinthians in chapter 12, verse 7 to 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 says, at least I should be exalted above measure Through the abundance of the revelation, there was given to me a thong in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, hit the brakes. Who gave it to him? A messenger of Satan, an imp, a demon of Satan. Saints of God, if you are walking with Jesus, Satan has assigned demons to you. Stay with the top of the show. He says, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. Verse 8, for this thing I besought the Lord twice, three times, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, I would rather glory in my infirmity, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches and necessities and persecutions and distresses for Christ's sake. For when I'm weak, yet I'm strong. Saints of God, did you hear what the apostle is writing? The apostle now, in this text, 12 and 1, he says, I knew a man about 14 years ago. He's speaking third person, whether in the body, out of the body, only God knows such a man. He said, I was taken up to a third heaven, that where I saw unspeakable things, things that's unlawful for me to utter. He said, I saw the deceased saints, and I saw the glory of God. He said, when I was in heaven, I had a heavenly blessing. But when I came back down to earth, I had a satanic blessing. He's saying that Satan blessed him, because when Satan thought that he was going to shut him down, he made Paul pray more earnestly. Paul said, now I pray to God three times. And God said, no, I won't remove it from you, Paul, because you're doing all right with it, Paul. You're praying now, Paul. You're with me now, Paul. You see, the Bible does not clarify what the infirmity was.
Right.
But it does make it plain where it come from. He said, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, a messenger of Satan. See, Satan thought he was going to make him turn away from God.
Yes.
But what it did, it gave him the spirit to pray more, Pastor.
Yes, yes.
He began to pray to God every day. And God says, I won't remove it because my grace is enough for you. See, there's some of us that God won't remove things from us, because if we do, we don't need God. I'm going to pray, I'm going to preach in a minute. You see, there's some of us that don't understand that God knows best. The apostle said that he takes pleasure in his approach.
Yes.
He takes pleasure in his persecution. In other words, what Satan meant for Paul's bad, God turned it around for his good. Somebody say amen. You know, understand here that God will allow a man to go through all kinds of things just so he will come closer to God. God uses Satan to teach his children. You see, if you're out there long enough and you get tired of being out there, then you'll know sooner or later that God is standing with his arms wide open. Come on home, because without God, where would you be? You see, bringing down a stronghold requires you to be humble. You must understand that a generational curse is when a child gets pregnant at 12, because her mother was pregnant at 13. And then a generational curse is when the grandson now is in the juvenile system. The grandfather's in penitentiary. The father's in penitentiary. And once they get you in a juvenile system, they got your name on there. And then when you become adult, if you do something, they'll say that you ain't learned nothing. So, see, the devil wants to lock you up. See, he wants to take that child that's 13 or 12 with a baby so she don't graduate from high school. You got to understand that these are strongholds. When a man declares that he can't stop smoking this crack cocaine. Now, you got to understand that that ain't nothing but a trick of the enemy. The enemy has said to him that this is you, the preacher don't know what he's talking about. Well, the preacher done been high. The preacher, and got tabo shanabaha. The preacher, the doctor told my mother, 19, I don't remember. That's a good thing. But I overdosed on cocaine.
Oh, Jesus.
I loved powder cocaine. Cocaine was my thing. I was playing bands, in and out of clubs, doing stand-up comedy. I ain't never been on stage sober. Why? The people I'm talking to are not sober, huh? But the devil tried to kill me before I got behind the sacred desk. The doctor told my mother I had enough cocaine in me to kill 4 people. You see me now? How you like me now? You see, God told me drugs is part of my ministry. I'm the drug czar. I come to tell you that the devil's a lie. I do admit and I confess there were times in my life that I thought that I could not make it without something. And not cocaine, but a little something, something. You got to have something, you know, to change my appetite, my attitude. The devil is a lie. He didn't take the addiction from me. He changed my drug of choice. I just said something. You see, I get high on the Holy Ghost. You don't hear me. And guess what? I ain't got to wait for him to re-up. Sometimes them drug dealers, you call them, they say, call back in a half an hour. Mm-hmm. I'm re-ing up. Mm-hmm. I'm back. Stuff like that. Come on, somebody say back. But sometimes he won't even answer the phone. See what I'm saying? Because most of them drug dealers, they're their best customer. I'm going to preach in a minute. You got to understand here, the bringing down of strongholds require effort that you want to get off of this junk. There ain't no such animal that you can't break. Jesus is the answer. He is able and willing to do you. Somebody said it. Good God Almighty. And when God cleans up a man, he'll send him back. Gotta take a man off Skid Row. Mm-hmm. Gotta take a man from under the bridge, Pastor Wells. Clean him up, fill him up with his spirit.
Yes.
Send him back to Skid Row. You know why? Because that man speaks the language.
That's right.
You got that double, sir. Yeah. See, a man that's strung out and homeless ain't going to listen to a man that's dressed well, ain't never sold his food stamps, huh? Huh? Ain't never left home and been gone for 3 or 4 days. But when you see a man come down there and they know him and he speaks the language, they want what he got. When they see a man all cool and hooked up, they say, give me $5. They want your money and keep moving. You can't even hang out with them. They want to know how you got clean. That's your opportunity to minister. That's your opportunity to tell them about Jesus. You see, God uses what you know.
Hallelujah.
To get somebody else to know him.
Amen.
It's all about him. Let me go ahead. I feel all right now. Praise the Lord. They're pulling down a stronghold. Amen. When I look here in Ephesians 6 and 10. Come on. Now. I'm going to get here. In Ephesians 6 and 10. Amen. I'm going to read Ephesians 6 and 10 to 17. Is that all right? Somebody say, come talk to me, prophet. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Finally, my brethren,
Be strong.
Be strong in the Lord and in his power of his might.
Amen.
Put on the whole armor of God. Huh?
That you may be able to
withstand. That ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. The tricks.
Yes.
The lies.
Yes.
Huh? He's cunning. Do you know, God says in Genesis, Pastor, he says the serpent is the craftiest creature he created. Yes. Crafty means by any means necessary. Yes. He wants you. And it got nothing to do with being fancy. Long as he can get you. Huh? Hey, and he'll get you through other people. The people that you associate with is full of the devil. It's a spirit. It's a spirit. Glory to God. Put on the whole armor of God. In other words, arm yourself. You see, the devil don't want no man that's armed. He don't want no man that's strapped. He want to get you when you're weak. Can I prove it? You look here in Old Testament when the Bible said, no, New Testament, when John baptized Jesus. The Bible said the Spirit led him in the wilderness. The Spirit led him, Spirit of God. 40 days and 40 nights, he didn't eat or drink nothing. Soon as he came out the wilderness, the Satan said, if you are, when God changes a man, Satan don't recognize you no more. He's sending stuff to your old address. God didn't change your address. When God changed your address, he changes your zip code. He changes your zip code, he changes your bank account. Good God Almighty. He said, if you are the Son of God, turn them two stones into bread and eat, because he know you're hungry. He thought he was weak. The Bible said that Jesus whipped him with the word. He said, behold, it is written, man can't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out the mouth of God. Hallelujah. Let me go to my close here in 1 Peter. 1 Peter 2 and 9. Stay with the prophet. I'm closing. Amen. 1 Peter 2 and 9. Burn down a stronghold. 1 Peter 2 and 9. Stay with me. I took my thing out. Hold on. The devil is alive. Right here. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. Pulling down a stronghold. 2 Peter. That's the one. Devil. Hey, that bullshit. Hey, guess what? I'm high right now. I love it. And you can get it too. Huh? You ain't got to have no money. 1 Peter 2 and 9. 2 and 9. It says, now James, it's all right. There it is. That's 5. That's all right. Y'all know me. I'm going to get there. But right now, so I ain't going to be selfish and I can sit down and, because I'm there. You have to work to get there. But I'm there. But I got to help my people. God sent me to help somebody. 2 and 9 says, amen. If I get out of James, I'll be all right. Huh? I see him. But ye are a chosen generation.
A royal priesthood.
A royal priesthood. A holy people. A peculiar people. Do you know the word peculiar mean there ain't no two of you?
That's right.
Peculiar is not normal.
Right.
A peculiar people.
Different.
Uh-huh. A royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, which in past time you were not a people, but now you are a people, which had not obtained mercy, but now you have attained mercy. The pulling down of strongholds. Hallelujah to God. You are a peculiar people, a people of God. Somebody shout that I'm breaking every stronghold because God gonna do it. God gonna bring me out. No matter what I go through, he's with me. He said, he told Moses to tell the Israelites, fear not, be of good character. I go before thee, because God did it. Somebody shout, he's going to do it for you too. You don't know God until you get down and out. When your back's against the wall, I come to tell you, he's a good God. He knew you. He said before he told Jeremiah, before I formed you in the womb of your mother, I knew thee. I ordained thee to be a prophet of the nation. Somebody say, yeah, and I to give you an expected end. Saints of God, God has a plan and a purpose for your life. And I pray. Hallelujah. Jesus came and took me on it. Everything that happened to me that was good, God did it. Oh, yes, he did. The pulling down of strongholds. You ain't got no strongholds. You just got a little something, something hanging on. You're clinging to it. You got to speak to your trouble. You got to speak to your enemy. You got to tell the devil to get out of my life. Get out of my way. Hallelujah to God. You command the devil to get out in Jesus' name. You say, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, he got to step back. Hallelujah.